Well, good morning. Good morning. We are so glad that you're here today. And it's beautiful to be out in the sun. And we're before the sun, S-O-N, and we're before the sun, S-U-N, shining upon us. They're both shining upon us. God is good. Look at your neighbor in the car there and just give him a high five from a distance. And over there, if I could have everybody turn to the car over there, Sandy is over there, and we're going to do something. If I could have everybody go in their cars for one moment. You know, I know you're in front. If you could just go into your cars there. We're going to do something we've probably never done before, and this is going to be fun. We're going to see your musical ability, but it happens to be Sandy's birthday. Sandy's birthday. So we're going to sing happy birthday. I'm going to need your help. We're going to sing happy birthday with our horns. Huh? Ready?
Oh, happy birthday to you. Oh, happy birthday to you. May you feel Jesus' cheer every day of the year. Happy birthday to you. Oh, happy birthday to you. And the best you've ever had.
Here it goes now.
And the best year you've ever had. And the best year you ever had.
Fireworks.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. And the best you ever had.
That was great. Wow. You guys are musical. Happy birthday, Sandy. Hey, listen, we're so glad you're here. And we're going to have a great time and a great moment in the Lord. And so for those watching online, we want to always invite you to Salem First Assembly. You know, getting Jesus into your heart will always help you in whatever situation you go through, because we're living in times today that we just don't know. But if you allow Jesus to just take each step one at a time, and that goes for all of us, he will help you. But if you look at your problem, then all of a sudden, you're not going to look at your Savior. God's greater than all. And he says, trust me. And sometimes when it gets tough, you still have to trust the Lord and do not grow weary or faint-hearted. You stay in it, and you'll win it in the name of Jesus. And so let's go before the Father, and let's pray. Father, we are grateful for today, another day you've given us, a beautiful day. Now, Lord, will you just touch each one that is here? Lord, will you touch each one that's watching through a video? And I pray, God, that you would do a work in each heart as they open it up to receive all that you have. Because, Lord, no matter when the winds blow, you're still the same God that says, peace, be still. And we ask this in the glorified, righteous name of Jesus Christ. And all God's people said, amen, amen. Let's worship the Lord.
Well, good morning, everybody. Everybody is joining us here at the drive-in, and everybody watching online. Let's worship the Lord and give him praise this morning if you're ready. Come on.
Good, and I dance because because you are good, and I shout because you are good. You are good
to me,
and I sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good. You are good. You're good to me. You're good to me. Please, you are good, you are good. In the sun rays, my heart celebrates. You are good, you are good. Hear the cry of praise, my heart will proclaim. You are good, and I shout because you are good. You are good to me, and I sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good. You are good. You're good to me. You're good to me.
Let's beep your horns if you're in your cars this morning. Just praise the Lord for all he's done. I'm thankful, Lord, for everything.
With a cry of praise, my heart will proclaim that you are good, you are good. In the sun or rain, my life celebrates that you are good. You are good. With a cry of praise, my heart will proclaim that you are good. You are good. In the sun rain, my life celebrates. You are good. You are good.
Thank you, Lord, for all that you've done, Lord. And Lord, there is none like you, Lord Jesus. You're the same yesterday, today, and forever, Lord. And Lord, we will stand on that promise, Lord, that you say you will never forsake us nor leave us, Lord. Lord, you are the same yesterday and forever, Lord. And we're so thankful, Lord, that you have all things in control, Lord. Lord, help us to not look around at what's going on in this world, but to keep our eyes focused on you, Lord. That we have to keep walking by faith and not by sight, Lord. That we have to remember that you are the one that holds all, and that you have everything for our life, Lord, that nothing in the world can fill us but your Holy Spirit, Lord. We're so thankful, Lord, and just as we continue to worship you, Lord, help us to remember all the needs we have on our hearts, Lord, and to know that you are the one that we need, Lord. You're the one we need to focus on these times, Lord. We are so thankful for all you've done, Lord. We declare this in the mighty name of Jesus, Lord. Amen. We thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
And I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're
working all things out. Oh, yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. In my highest heavy in all my days. Oh yes, I will. And I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God is never late. It's working all things out. It's working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will for all my days. Oh yes, I will. And I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify your name of all names. And nothing can stand against it. I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. Nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. And nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. And nothing can stand against, oh yes, I will. Lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will. When my heart is heavy in all my days, oh yes, I will. For all my days, oh yes, I will. For all my days, oh yes, I will. I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. Nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. And nothing can stand against, oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will for all my days. Oh yes, I will for all my days. Oh yes, I will. Raise your name. You have the one the victory, Lord. Nothing's impossible for the mighty name of Jesus, Lord. We're going to declare that today. Yeah, hallelujah. You have won the victory. Yeah, hallelujah. You have won. stripes we are healed. By his nail-pierced stands we're free. By his blood we're washed clean. Now we have the victory.
And our God is
reigns on high. Our God is risen. He is alive. He won the victory. He reigns on high.
Hallelujah. Can someone, he reigns. Someone say he reigns. Whatever situation, whatever problem, whatever thing that's upon your heart that seems to be heavy, he reigns. I want you to just take a moment to see, what is that situation? What is that thing that's upon your heart? What is that heaviness upon your shoulder? And then I want you to tell yourself, he reigns. He reigns. Do not carry, but cast all your cares upon him, because everybody say it, he reigns. He reigns. He reigns and rules. And where God's peace reigns, he rules. Because he loves us and wants to do a work in us. Let's go before the Father and let's invite him to say, God, have your way. Have your way. You have a circumstance. You have a situation. Have your way, Lord. I'm going to yield myself to you, Father, in the name of Jesus. We sing these songs because they declare who you are. They declare your promises. They declare your truth of your word. Lord, help us to take your word, the scriptures, and put them to our life. And Lord, as we believe them and walk in them, Lord, we know you're going to work everything out. And when you do, you're going to rise up a testimony from the test. And Lord, will you just continue to do a work in our hearts and draw our hearts ever so close to you. We thank you for this day. And Lord, we profess with our mouth and we remind ourselves, you reign. You reign. You reign and rule over all that happens. And so, Father, we now walk in faith, trust in you. We're going to trust and not rust. We're going to keep moving by faith, walking one step at a time. And in that, Lord, will you teach us, grow us, strengthen us, and rise us up to the full potential you have created us to be. In Jesus' name, someone say amen or beep your horns and give some praise to the high. Because he's worthy, he's worthy, he's worthy, he's worthy. There's none like the Lord. There's none like the Lord. He is your rock. Even when you think, well, he may be sleeping. Well, the disciples thought that too, didn't they? And they had all the waves coming in their boat, and they're like, don't you care that we're going to perish? And then he said to them, oh, ye of little faith. He got up, looked at the winds, looked at the waters, and simply said, be still. The God who created all this, all that you see, is the God in which we serve. And this is such a little portion. Let me share the one little moment with you. Is when you look down to the ground, what do you see? You probably see about 10 square feet of land. That's all you see. But when you look up, how much more do you see? Good, look up. How much more do you see? But look down. You see, sometimes all we can see is what we see, because that's the only thing we're looking at. But when we look to the Master, when we look to the Savior, something happens in the living tabernacle, and we're reminded, someone say it, he reigns. He reigns. Hallelujah. Give him some praise. Give him some praise. He's worthy. So worthy. It is a joy for me to have Pastor Jason here today, and he has an incredible testimony of where he's been, him and his wife. And I know you're going to be blessed by this because here's an individual who has kind of walked the trenches of a little bit of what all of us have been experiencing. So I'm going to invite Pastor Jason to come up here, and you can use the ladder of your youth, and you can just jump up. What do you like to do? All right. You can tell a little bit of your background. I'm not going to say, but he'll tell you a little bit of his background into where God has brought him and what he just came from and what God has laid on his laid on his heart. So I hope this is a blessing to you. And if you're watching by social media and Facebook and YouTube, listen, I would love for you to share this message to be an encouragement to someone who's going through some things, gone through some things, and to know there is a hope. There is an answer, and the answer is Jesus Christ, the creator of all things that we see before us. So, Lord bless you, brother. Yes. I'm so glad you're here.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Brian. Salem First Assembly, you have an awesome pastor, Pastor Brian and Pastor Paula. Thank you so much for inviting me to come share this morning. I just told Pastor during worship that I had a minor surgery on my foot earlier this week, and last week it was in so much pain I was hardly able to walk, and praise God, this morning I'm able to climb a ladder. So praise God for that. It is so good to be with you this morning here to share what God has put on my heart. And just to share with you, about 6-7 years ago, I think it was, when I first met your pastor, we were at one of our district council meetings down in Ocean City. And I don't have to say something that you don't already know about your pastor, but he has a heart for the lost. Amen. We were just briefly talking, and we were walking up back to our rooms, and there was a young employee who was working for the hotel, and we just started to share the love of God with him and ended up praying with him to invite Jesus into his heart. And that is such a wonderful thing. And just walking into your church and seeing all the missionaries that your church supports once again shows the heart of your pastor and you as well to support missionaries around the world. So my name is Jason Scalzi. I am born and raised in South Jersey, and I'm a retired police officer. I retired from Vineland back in 2016 and was pastoring my wife and I and our family up in Tinton Falls for 3 years. And in the career field that I was serving in, you can imagine with the climate that the world is in today, it is a very stressful, high-demanding job, just as pastors ministry is as well. So I was doing that for 20 years and pastoring a church for 3 years, and it was time to take a break and spend some time with my family. So that's what I was doing since October. I was taking a break until I got an email back in March 19th, I believe it was, and the email was, we're looking for chaplains for Cremona, Italy. And so you can imagine the law enforcement, with everything that's going on in the world with the law enforcement community, and then everything that was going on in Cremona, Italy with the COVID-19. And my wife and I called her up and I says, honey, do you want to go to Italy? Now, I was telling my wife that I was going to take her to Italy for about a year. I said, honey, I'm going to take you on a trip. We're going to go to Italy. We're going to go to Florence. We're going to get in the boat, and we're going to just go down the rivers, and we're going to go to Rome and all these beautiful spots. And so when I asked her to go to Italy, it was with the Samaritan's Purse, Billy Graham Evangelistic Association chaplain team. It wasn't exactly what I had anticipated or what she had anticipated. So if she was here today, she would say, yeah, that doesn't count for our trip to Italy. So I'll have to bring her back again. But we went and we served as chaplains in the hot spot where COVID-19 was really affecting the community. And the hospital that we were set up across the street had 600 patients in this hospital. 100 of them were all doctors and medical personnel who had contracted the virus. So we immediately began to pray against strongholds, against death. We immediately began to pray against strongholds of religion, and that God would do great miracles in not only Cremona, but all of Italy and throughout all the world. And there was the statistics were that if you were on a ventilator, if you were in ICU, 100% of the people died. And we said, God, we can't stand for this. We need life. We need a miracle. We began to pray, Lord, we're asking for a miracle. And there was a video that was posted on the Billy Graham page. A gentleman by the name of Francesco was in ICU. They told him that he was not going to live, but we believed otherwise, right? But God. We believed that God was going to do a miracle. And I can say that he was discharged out of the ICU tent into another tent where I was able to speak with him. He spoke very good English, and I was able to share my faith with him and lead him to Christ. He invited Jesus into his heart, and he was discharged. So he was the first of many that accepted Christ and came to faith in Christ. So I'm going to share a few more testimonies as we get through, but that is just a little bit of who I am and before all that, I'm a follower of Christ. All those things, being a retired police officer, being a chaplain, don't mean anything. My identity, our identity is in Christ, amen? That's what matters, is who our identity is in. I want to talk a little bit about fear this morning. We understand when circumstances like this come up, fear can grip our hearts. I'm going to be honest, when I first got to, well, even before I got to Italy, when I had told family, my son, when Damaris and I told our children that we were going to Italy, when we posted on social media that we were going to Italy, we got responses immediately. What are you guys, crazy? What are you guys, fools? Somebody said, are you a fool? I'm a fool for Jesus, right? When Jesus says go, we got to go. We all know the story of Jonah, right? When Jonah ran from the Lord, he got on a ship and went in the opposite direction from Nineveh. You're safer to be in the perfect plan of God than you are to be in beautiful Salem County. Amen? When God calls you to go, you go. So so there was a little bit of fear. And fear, when as a law enforcement officer, will save your life, right? There's plenty of times when I was in danger, and there was a little bit of fear. It helps you to take calculated risks. But when you are in Christ and the Holy Spirit is living inside of you, we just celebrated Pentecost service last week. Amen. The outpouring of the Holy Spirit to be what? To be witnesses, to be bold witnesses for Christ. So Damaris and I, we obeyed the Lord, and we went, and we did not know what to expect when we got to Italy, but God sure did. And so there was that little bit of fear when I had the N95 mask on and we were working 12, 13 hours a day of running around, and my chest started to get a little tight, and I had a little difficulty breathing. And so at night I went and I laid down and I said, honey, my chest is feeling a little bit tight. I'm a little concerned. And she had to remind me, hey, you've been wearing a mask, you know, for all day. So there are these fears that come upon you, but if fear grips you, fear is the lack of faith, and we're going to talk a little bit about this morning. Acts 2:40. I'm going to read from Acts chapter 2, and then I'm going to go into the text of what I really want to share about fear this morning. We just celebrated Acts chapter 1 and Acts chapter 2 verses 1 last week of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, and the disciples, they were now filled with the Holy Spirit, right? Paul, prior to being filled with the Holy Spirit, he denied knowing Christ. When he received the baptism of the Holy Spirit and he spoke in tongues as the Spirit of God gave him utterance, he now was filled with boldness and preached the gospel, and 3,000 people came to faith in Christ. So the disciples must have thought, even the two that were on the road to Emmaus, you know, they were leaving Jerusalem because they were, what do we do now, Lord? What do we do next? And I read this as I was preparing this message, and this is, I believe, what God wants us to do next. We are meeting outside in this beautiful parking lot behind your beautiful sanctuary. And I had told my church for 3 years that I was pastoring, I said, what happens if this building burns down? I says, is this the church? I says, if we're not here, is this the church? The church is where the body of Christ is. I'm so glad that you came this morning because you are the church. Amen? We're having church because we have come together. So this is what the early disciples in Acts chapter 2, verse 42 says, and they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And all came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their home, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all people. And the Lord added to the number day by day those who were being saved. How many of us want to see the Lord add to the church day by day those being saved? Hallelujah. Yes. Yes. And I believe that because of this pandemic, that the Lord is doing exactly that, because there are so many churches that did not have an online presence with social media, with Facebook Live, and with other things. But now the gospel is being spread not only to beautiful Salem County through the work that Pastor Brian and Pastor Paula and you guys are doing, but now through the presence of social media. That's an amazing thing that God is doing. God is adding to the church daily. So as I was talking with your pastor yesterday and just hearing some of the things that your church has gone through and the body of Christ has gone through, I wanted to talk a little bit about fear. Fear is an unpleasant emotion caused by the belief that someone or something is dangerous, likely to cause pain or threat. All of us have fears of some sort. Some of us fear the future, the unknown, or sickness. We can be afraid of other people, of failure, or of being alone. Regardless of our particular fear, all fear is a result of a lack of trust and dependence upon God. When we are focused on God, His love for us, we are not afraid, no matter what the circumstances we face. Billy Graham says, fear is our enemy. We know that. Fear is our enemy. It'll keep you from doing what God has called you to do. There's so many times where God has put something on my heart, and next thing you know, I have this fear. Oh, maybe people are going to laugh at me, or maybe people won't accept what I have to say, or just different attacks of the enemy. That's one of the tactics of the enemy, is to put fear in your heart to get you to stop doing what God has called you to do by sharing your faith with somebody, by telling somebody that God loves them, by asking somebody, can I pray for you? These are all things that God has commanded us to do. And the Holy Spirit was given to us so that we could be bold witnesses. The Holy Spirit will give you power in that day, in that moment, to speak truth. So fear is our enemy. Jesus says we are not to fear. We are not to be anxious. We are not to fret. We are not to worry. Scripture teaches that this type of fear is sin. Jesus' words in John 14:27 says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives to you, I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, let it be afraid. I think of, I shared a little bit of Francesco. He was discharged, he was brought out of the ICU tent, and he was sitting in outside. It was a beautiful day like this in Italy. He was sitting outside and he was reading. And I began to share with him. I didn't know that this was the individual that we had been praying for until he mentioned his name. The moment that he mentioned his name, I said, Francesco, thousands of people have been praying for you. And it was the week right after Resurrection Sunday. And I shared with him that Jesus rose from the grave. I said, sickness has no control over you. Coronavirus has no control over you. And I was able to share with him, and his words were, it works. Prayer works. And he invited Jesus into his heart. There was another individual. He was a patient in the male ward. And when I got to work, I looked over and I saw fear over his life, through his eyes. And that was one of the most difficult things, was wearing a mask pretty much all day, every day. The moment that we walked out of our hotel room, we had to have the mask on. We couldn't take it off until we got back into the room, or when we were sitting down to eat and it could come off for a minute. So we didn't know what each other looked like. We didn't know what the staff members of Samaritan's Purse, or the doctors, or the nurses, or the interpreters, or the police officers. I didn't know what they looked like, because you're looking at them in their eyes. And I can tell you that this gentleman who was sitting down outside the ward had fear all over him. And he spoke English. I believe he was from Nigeria. And I called him over. We had a barricade of about 6 feet between us. And one of the things that my wife and I did was after we got to the hospital in the morning, we would pray, and then we would distribute food to all the patients. And we had to put it up on this wooden platform and push it across. And once the food went across into the contaminated area, whether it was a mistake or not, it couldn't come back because it was contaminated. So that's what we did all day long. So this gentleman was sitting other side of the fence in the contaminated area. I called him to me, and I said, "You're afraid, aren't you?" And when I said that, he looks at me, tears welling up in his eyes, and said, "Yes." See, in his mind, he wasn't sick. In his mind, he wasn't going in that tent, because in that tent, there were sick people, and they were very sick. You could hear them coughing all day, all night, and he was not going in that tent. And it was going to get cold in about 2 hours, so I had to, you know, do something. I had to be available to God to see how I could get him to understand that he was going to have peace this night. So I shared with him the story of Daniel. And I'm sure when Daniel was thrown in the lion's den, he probably was a little afraid, right? It's okay to say that he may have been a little afraid. I think I would have been a whole lot afraid. But when Daniel got in that lion's den, what did he do? He began to worship his God. He began to sing praises to God. And I guarantee it, I told this gentleman, I said, "I bet you Daniel had the best sleep of his life, because he went in there knowing that God was with him and that he was going to have peace." And we know the story. Amen? He was fine. And those lions were hungry, weren't they? So I told this gentleman, I said, "I believe that God wants you to have the best sleep of your life." There may be some that are here. There may be some that are going to be watching later on that you have not had sleep, that you have been struggling, whether your fears or doubts or worries. God wants you to have the best sleep of your life, because he loves you. He cares for you. He wants you to have shalom, be full of joy and peace. So I prayed with that individual. And then we had another interpreter who was a spirit-filled believer. We had a couple of them and doing a great work over in Italy right now. And so I asked my friend Karen, I said, "Karen, can you pray with him?" And I had to walk away and do a few things. I come back 20 minutes later, and I'm like, "Where's he at?" He was gone. Guess where he was at? He was inside the tent sleeping, had a peaceful night. And that night, there was a gentleman that passed away. And this gentleman that had fear over his life slept through it. He got out, came out the next day. He surrendered his life to the Lord. And just another amazing story of God's faithfulness in the midst of this pandemic. So a couple years ago, I went to Israel. And I went up to Caesarea Philippi. And there's the story of Matthew 16, we're going to get to the root of this fear and where it actually comes from. And we're going to deal with it. And we're going to allow God to break fear over our lives today. Can I hear an amen or a honk of your horn? Amen. Amen. So in Matthew 16, verses 13 through 19, Jesus was taking his disciples, and I heard this say he was taking them on a field trip. It was quite a distance to walk. I mean, we drove there from the Galilee area, and it took us about an hour and a half to 2 hours of driving and through mountainous terrain and rugged terrain. And they said that it would have taken about 12 days or 12 hours for Jesus and the disciples to walk there. And I heard Jesus was taking his disciples on a field trip to the gate of hell. Chapter 16, verse 13 says, "Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, 'Who do people say that the Son of Man is?' And they said, 'Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets.' He said to them, 'But who do you say that I am?' Simon Peter replied, 'You are the Christ, the Son of the living God.' And Jesus answered him, 'Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven.'" For those who have been to Israel and actually have seen with their very eyes this location, this was a place where Greek mythology and the god of Pan, they had a grotto, which was a thing that was built, an altar, a temple that was built to the god of Pan in the side of the rock. And there was an actual cave where water came out of that in Greek mythology was the gate to hell. And Pan, we know that the Greek word Pan, there's a lot of words that can't come from that. Paranoia or pandemic, right? Which is fear. So that word pandemic has its root words in fear. Isn't that amazing that things like this have its root words in fear. I was reading, it says, this word implies a division between the common people and the elite. That's one of the things that Satan wants to do, is to divide the church, divide and conquer, bring division in the body of Christ. He does that through many different things, through fear, through the pandemic, through what's happening in the law enforcement community and the injustices that are done. He tries to divide the church. But those who are followers of Jesus, who are filled with the Holy Spirit, we need to be aware of these things. And we can't allow fear to grip our hearts. Amen. We need to trust God's word for what it says and believe it and work these things out. The ancient Greeks also considered Pan to be the god of theatrical criticism. Wow. None of us, right? It's none of us that criticize things. But there's people, you know, in the world. There's people in the church, you know, that they criticize everything. That's one of the roots of the god of Pan. One story involving Pan is a tale of war in which Pan helps his friend to survive a vicious struggle by letting out an immense cry that frightened the enemy and caused him to run away. From this story, we get the word panic, the sudden, uncontrollable fear that leads people into irrational behavior. Wow. Man, we see that on the news, right? It leads people into irrational behavior. Let it never be said of the body of Christ, of the Church of Jesus Christ, to be led of irrational behavior. We must, in all things, through prayer and supplication, right? 1 Peter 5:7, cast all your care upon me, for I care for you. I love the scripture in 2 Timothy 1:6-7 says, for this reason I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God has not given us a spirit, not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. When you're in the midst of this pandemic, and some of you have been touched by it, some of you have loved ones that maybe have been sick or even passed away. It's a real thing. And Damaris and I, who were in the middle of it, people were dealing with it. And I can tell you that for a country that for so many years is a very religious country, having a form of godliness, beautiful churches, but no power, no freedom, no liberty. In fact, one of the pastors, friends of mine, had gone to the director of the hospital for 6 years. Every year he would go to the hospital and say, can I set up a table so I can give out Gideon Bibles to the patients? And the director was like, frankly, we're not interested. Well, this pandemic hit, and isn't it amazing that God turns all things around for good to those that love him and are called according to his purpose? When we first got there, set up the tent, we had no resources to give out. And through a couple of contacts, I was able to get in contact with Pastor Vito Bergio, an Assembly of God pastor in Cremona, Italy. And he reached out and was able to deliver 3 cases of Gideon New Testaments. Isn't that awesome? It could have been any other New Testament, but it was Gideon Bibles. And we gave out those 3 cases, which was about 150 Bibles in about a week, to every family member. Every family member. Yeah, man, that deserves a honk. Come on. Yes. Praise the Lord. Woo! Hallelujah. We gave out a New Testament Bible with a DVD, La Croce, The Cross, from the Billy Graham Organization. A book called Vivere in Cristo, Living for Christ. Every patient that was discharged got a Bible. Every family member who came who wanted a Bible got a Bible. Every police officer who gave their hearts to Jesus got a Bible. Every translator who gave their heart to Jesus got a Bible. Over 300 Bibles were distributed to people who are hungry for the gospel. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Praise God for that. So we know that in the midst of panic, in the midst of a pandemic, God is still on the throne. He is still in control. You guys are meeting outside, and we're taking every precautionary measure. Praise God. We have to be wise. But I don't want you to live in fear. I know in a couple weeks or months, when you begin to start meeting back inside. And if it's like this every Sunday, why not meet outside so all your neighbors can hear the gospel? But I don't want you to live in fear. Know that God is in control. There was a young individual, he was a photographer that came in with the nurses from the hospital and got a tour, and I thought he was with the nurses and the doctors from Cremona Hospital, but he was a reporter that just saw all the commotion, and he just comes on in. There's no such thing as coincidence with God, right? So I thought he was with them. He's walking around, he's taking pictures, and after all the nurses and the medical staff from the hospital left, he's hanging out. He's still staying there, and one of our interpreters, who's a great Christian brother, says, "Jason, come here." And I came, and I started to share the gospel with him. And the presence of God was so evident on his life. And all I had to ask him, "Are you ready to invite Jesus into your life?" He says, "Yes." And that was the first day that I broke the rules. I turned around to make sure that our team leader wasn't looking, and had to give this brother a great big Holy Spirit-filled hug, because he was, the greatest miracle of all just took place where he invited Jesus into his life. I want to share what this newsletter that I just received from the Billy Graham Rapid Response Team just came out a couple weeks ago, and if you're on their newsletter, you may have got it as well. Perfect love casts out fear. This was a report from Italy. Absolutely not. That's what the Billy Graham Rapid Response Chaplain, Jason Scalzi, told Luca, a COVID-19 patient at the field hospital in Italy. When he asked if the chaplains were afraid to be there, Jason continued, "The moment we heard of the need here and the people dying and their sickness, we wanted to come. It's the love of Christ that compels us to go, and that perfect love casts out fear." Once a healthy athlete, Luca was growing impatient and worried with his illness. The chaplains deploy to offer a listening ear, encouragement, and prayer, and they look for opportunities to share the hope of Jesus Christ. Jason explained to Luca, "We're chaplains, but more than that, we're followers of Jesus." The two men engaged in a long conversation about the love of God and his offer of salvation. The more the chaplain shared, the more Luca's heart softened. Finally, Luca said that he wanted to accept Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. He prayed to repent of his sins and invite the Lord into his life. One local pastor has provided cases of Italian New Testaments, and Jason handed one to Luca. On my way driving here this morning, that pastor who I had shared, who provided the a total of five cases of New Testament Bibles, sent me a message, sent me a WhatsApp photograph. His church was right around the corner from the hotel where we were staying at. The first day that I met Pastor Vito, he was weeping and weeping. He had three members of his congregation that had passed away, and two others were in ICU, and it did not look good for them. But we prayed for those two that were in ICU, and I can give you a report that they are doing well. They have been discharged from the hospital, and praise God for that. But what Pastor Vito shared with me today was a picture of his congregation. Today was the first Sunday since the beginning of February where they have gathered together in their building. And he just gave a great report. He says, "Jason, thank you so much for the work that you and Samaritan's Purse have done in my city, Cremona. God is doing a great work." So please keep Pastor Vito and his congregation in your prayers as they continue to serve the Lord. And we're praying for a great harvest of souls, not only in Cremona, but in the city of Milan, which is an hour north, where my wife and I will be going back in January. Franklin Graham is going to be doing an evangelistic outreach up there. And we're praying for not only hundreds, but thousands of people to come to Christ. So I want to close with this. We talked about fear, and we talked about perfect love that casts out all fears. If you're here this morning and maybe you've got lost, you know, we need to have that compass. The Bible is our compass to guide us in all truth. And also, those that are going to be watching later on, I want to share this story with you that Will Graham had posted. He says, "Check your compass." Will and Franklin, his father, they're all pilots, and they love to fly. He says, it was the spring of 1997, and the day had finally come for my first solo cross-country flight. I had been training to be a pilot from some time, and now I would have to show my ability by taking off, landing, and refueling at several different airports on a day-long journey. I proceeded through all my checks, accelerated down the runway, and peeled off into the morning sky. It didn't take me long to realize that I had messed up. How many of us at times realize where, you know, we started our journey, but even leaving the house, but we realized that maybe we didn't put on the armor of God, that we didn't pray. We didn't start off our day seeking the face of God. We realized that, hey, we messed up. You see, before you take off, it's vitally important to set the gyroscopic compass to your magnetic heading. You must do this every time because without it, you have virtually no chance of getting where you're going. That could be a little bit scary, a little bit fearful, right? Not knowing where you're going. Unfortunately, I had been too nervous, and though I thought I had checked each and every box, I failed to set the compass immediately appropriately. At this point, lifting off into the sky, I had a choice to make. Would I acknowledge my mistake, turn around, set the plane back down on the runway, and do it right? Or would I keep going on my own way, trying to figure it out as I went, even if I meant that I would be completely off course? Sadly, I let my pride win out. I couldn't bring myself to return to the airfield below, and I sped ahead into the wide open. In this case, my mistake, followed by my refusal to acknowledge it, did not end in disaster. I was able to level out the plane and use the old floating magnetic compass to dial in my gyroscopic compass while in the air. But what if I hadn't? What if I had stubbornly refused to accept my mistake and done nothing to correct it? What if I had stacked bad decision on top of bad decision? Frankly, I might not be here to write these pages. I could have spent hours searching blindly for the right airstrip and eventually run out of fuel. I would not have found the right path, the one had been laid out for me. I am afraid that my sky-high dilemma is an analogy for a common condition that many of us face. You know that you are on the wrong track. You understand that you've made poor decisions. In some cases, it's one bad choice that has disastrous consequences, and yet you refuse to acknowledge your struggle or your failing. You refuse to land the proverbial plane and reset your trajectory. You blindly stumble along on your own way, even though it's a path that leads to destruction. Whatever is going on in your life today, please check your spiritual compass and ensure that you are on the right path. It may be a relationship that you know isn't right. Maybe it's an addiction, a sin, or a passion that becomes an idol, pulling you away from your Savior. Perhaps you've hurt someone, and it's time to ask for forgiveness. Regardless, point your compass to Jesus. Follow His word. Set heaven as your destination. And He, in Proverbs, says that He will direct your paths. So that's the wonderful thing with Christ. Amen. That we can reset our trajectory. We may have started off well and got off track, but the moment that we get off track, the moment that we realize it, we humble ourselves and say, God, I have gotten off track. Forgive me. He immediately forgives us. Amen. He immediately sets us on a new trajectory path. And I encourage you this morning, wherever you're at with the Lord, those who are watching, wherever you're at with the Lord, put your faith and confidence in Jesus today. Run after Jesus with all your heart. Don't allow the cares of this world to take your eyes off of Christ. Don't go to the left or to the right, but stay the course. Have your spiritual compass focused on Jesus. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Lord, we worship You. We worship You. Father, I thank You, Lord, for Your presence here today. Lord, we thank You where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom and liberty. There is healing in Your presence, O God. For those that are maybe sick in body, Lord, I pray that the power of the Holy Spirit, if you're sick in body, or if you're a family member sick in body, go ahead and just raise your hand and just call on the Lord. Call on the Lord and say, Lord, You are my healer. Father, I pray for healing to flow, Lord God, physical healings to take place, miracles to take place. Lord, I pray for spiritual healings, O God, in the lives of Your people. Lord, I thank you for this opportunity to bring your word. And Lord, I thank you for this wonderful church that's doing a wonderful work here in Salem County. I pray that you would pour out your spirit, Lord God, upon each family that's represented here. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen. Praise God. Come on, let's, hallelujah, we worship you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Praise the Lord. God is good. You know, one of the things I want you to go with is that Pastor Jason and his wife answered the call to fill a need. And you know what? God wants you to find him, and then what can you do for him? People are touched. People are changed. People are helped because individuals get involved with other people's lives. It's so easy to help those who are doing well, but it's really up to the church to help those who are not doing so well. That's what rises up a testimony for their lives, but also to realize what God's doing in you. You see, you have to care. If you're not caring for others, you're not growing. I'm going to say that again. If you're not caring for others and you're just talking and looking unto yourself, you will not grow spiritually. It's those things that you need to grow in God as you care for others. That's why Philippians 2 is so important, where it says, do not look unto your own interests, but the interests of others. Esteem others higher than yourselves. And Jason and his wife left, you know, here to go into a hot area that people and friends and family thought he was crazy. Why would you put yourself at risk? But you forget the one who put himself at risk. Jesus Christ, who really put his hands into his own creation and suffered. This is what love is. Love does. Love actually does something. And I'm proud of what Jason and his wife did and so many others that worked the work in the midst, left the comfort zone to see what God's going to do in the holy zone. And that's what God wants to do with each one of you. The first thing is make him his Savior, and Jason challenged each of you of putting Christ first. But the second challenge that he gave was, you know, that you got to trust him. You got to see what God wants to do. Life's not over until you stop breathing. Until then, there's work to do. Amen? So my prayer for you is to see what God's trying to still do in you. It's not like, yeah, done it, did it, got the shirt, wore it out, it's all ripped, and now I'm ready to go home. No, that's not gospel. Gospel is, as Paul said, I fought the fight, the good fight. I have finished the race. And you can say that on the day that you're finally going to meet your Savior. But until then, there's work to do. There's work to do. There's souls to be touched. There's individuals that need you to come into their life. You need to touch someone. You need to help people. And everybody doing something can change the world for someone. It takes just one person to make a difference. Don't live so self-centered. There's a lot of needs out there, but when you allow fear to rule, God can't reign. Don't be afraid. Be wise. Be smart. Listen and learn, but always walk in faith, and God will meet you. Listen, this journey has been very difficult for me and my family. There's been so many things going on that most of you don't even know. And yet, in the midst of it all, God has been so good, so faithful, through so many challenges, one after another, after another, after another, after another. It wasn't just one challenge, or two challenges, or three challenges, or four. It was a multiple of challenges all coming down all at the same time. And yet, the God of our salvation was there. And in the midst of the waves and the storms, he builds the inside of the house. He builds character. He builds strength. He helps in the time of hurt. That's your God. And if God desires to do that for you, can we make a commitment before the God today that we'll do it for others? We won't be so self-centered about what we are. This world is a little crazy we're living in today. It's changing so fast. But God's called you to be a peacemaker. God's called you to do something. Don't just live a life for yourself, but I love what Jason did and his wife, and he has a heart to serve. Aren't we all called to serve? Aren't we all called to serve? Jesus washed the feet, taught the best lesson in the world. He who is Lord and Savior and God of the world knelt down to wash the feet of his disciples. And yes, Judas was there too. And he washed the feet. We're just here to serve. That's all we're here. Just live to serve God, to serve others. Connect to God, connect to others. And let's see what God was going to do. The best is yet to come. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for who you are and all that you are doing. And even though there are struggles, and even though there are things that are complicated, and even though there are hurts, and there are times where we feel so harmed by so many different things, you are our healer, you are our source, you are our strength. You have said what you have said, and you have told us what you will do. You have called us children, and you have called us more than conquerors. Now, Lord, I pray for each one here today that they would walk in the very plan that you have for them, looking unto you, God, and seeing where you desire to use them to touch others. And if it gets a little messy, let them love greater than the mess so they can walk in to see how you will bless. And, Father, we will give you all the praise and all the glory in the name of Jesus. And can you all honk your horns and give some praise to God? Blessed be his name. Blessed be your name. You're worthy, worthy. Blessed be your name. You are worthy, O Lord. Hallelujah.